Hello. This set of mini lectures is going to be about electrostatics. Electrostatics is treating charged particles at rest. One really great example of electrostatics is static electricity. You all have experienced static electricity whenever you pull off a, you know, fleece sweater and you touch something metal. You are transferring charges between yourself and, let's say, a doorknob, and that has some energy associated with it, and you produce the shock, the charge exchange. Here we have a cat with a balloon. A balloon is a really great device you can use to rub on a piece of material in order to transfer charge. You can transfer charge. That balloon now has some charge on it, and you could hover it over top of your cat, and then the cat's hair will stand on end because the hair is being attracted to the charge on the balloon. Matter is made up of electrons, which are negatively charged, and protons, which are positively charged, and we have neutrons, which have zero charge. So here we have an atom. We've got our nucleus in the middle, which has neutrons and protons. The protons give the nucleus a positive charge. And then we have electrons that orbit in these orbital shells around the nucleus of the atom, and those electrons have a negative charge. So an object is neutral if it has the same amount of negative charge as it does positive charge. Now, charge is quantized. That means you cannot have half a charge, you cannot have three quarters of a charge, you can only have integer number of charges. So all charged objects carry an integer number multiple of our basic quantity of charge. Now, a proton, these things are all on your equation sheet. A proton has a mass of 1.67 times 10 to the minus 27 kilograms. It's a little bit heavier than an electron. An electron has a mass of 9.11 times 10 to the minus 31 kilograms, but they both have, so even though the masses are different, the proton is heavier, they both have the same absolute value for the charge. Protons have a charge of positive 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. That's our unit for charge, is a coulomb, which we abbreviate as capital C. And electrons have a charge of minus 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. So one proton has this charge, a positive charge of this quantity, and one electron has a negative charge of this quantity. Objects are neutral if they have the same number of positive and negative charges. We already mentioned that. Objects have an overall negative charge if they have more negatively charged particles than positively charged particles. And you can say the same thing in reverse. Objects have an overall positive charge if they have more positively charged particles than negatively charged particles. And there's a bunch of different ways you can take a neutral object and remove charge or move or redistribute the charges within that object. When we talk about charge, physics professors like to drag out their Van de Graaff machine. You might have seen one of these before. We have one at Delta State, but I don't even know when the last time was that it was plugged in. So I'm a little bit intimidated by it. Who knows? It might have been the 70s since it was last used. But in any case, this is what they look like. When a person touches the Van de Graaff machine, the person will assume is neutral. When they touch the Van de Graaff generator, some of that person's electrons, the electrons in their body, are attracted to the Van de Graaff generator here. And that results in a loss of electrons from the person that those electrons are attracted to, the Van de Graaff generator here. And that leaves the person with an overall positive charge. And this excess of positive charge causes things like hair to stand on their ends, because like charges repel, but opposite charges attract. So if you're overall positive charge, your hair has additional positive charges, they're all going to stand up. All the strands of your hair are going to stand up and try to repel each other. Suppose this person puts their hands on the Van de Graaff machine, and the machine removes 9 times 10 to the 20 electrons from that person. What is their overall net charge? The person is going to start out as a neutral charge, the same number of protons as electrons. They put their hand on the Van de Graaff machine. It removes 9 times 10 to the 20 electrons from you. So now you're left with an addition, an excess of 9 times 10 to the 20 protons, or 9 times 10 to the 20 positive charges. So then, to figure out what this person's net overall positive charge is, you would have to take this excess of 9 times 10 to the 20 protons times the charge on one proton, which is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. So to get this person's overall net charge, whenever they've touched the Van de Graaff machine, you would take 9 times 10 to the 20 protons in excess times 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs, which is the charge on one proton. And then that would give you an overall excess charge of 144 coulombs, positive, because you're left with additional protons. Just like we had a law of conservation of energy, energy is exchanged, but it's not destroyed. There's also a law of conservation of charge. The total charge is always constant in any process. You can have exchange of charge, but if you draw a box around that whole system, the same number of charges are going to be present. So the charge on any object can change, but the total charge of our system remains the same. We don't create new charges, and they can only move from one place to another. So like energy, momentum, angular momentum, stuff we talked about last semester, charge is also a conserved quantity. We're going to think about the law of conservation of charge by rubbing two objects together and exchanging charges between them. Here we have two originally neutral objects, which means that they both on their own have the same number of positive and negative charges. We'll say that the cloth has 3 negative charges and 3 positive charges, which means it's a net neutral zero number of excess charges. We have amber here, which we're going to say is also a neutral object. It's got 2 positive charges, 2 negative charges. Now, we're going to rub them together. And in the end, we exchange electrons. Most of the time, or usually when we think about when objects are transferring charge, you can think about it as the electrons that are flowing or moving between the objects. So we've transferred 2 electrons in this process here that we described when we rub these two objects together. We've transferred 2 electrons from my originally neutral cloth over to my amber. So now the amber still has its plus 2 charge, but now it has minus 4 on its negative charge. It's got 4 electrons, which means that overall it has a net charge of minus 2. It's got 2 extra electrons compared to protons. And over here on our cloth, it has a net positive charge. So it was really, in this case, the cloth that gave up 2 of its electrons that got exchanged over to the amber. So now the amber has an excess of electrons, and our cloth has a deficiency of electrons, which leaves it with a net positive charge. Some materials are insulators, and these are materials which don't allow for the free flow of electrons. But conductors are materials that allow for the free flow, free movement of electrons. Usually in conductors, you have, you know, the electrons that are orbiting around the nucleus of the atom, and some of those electrons are free to move around and to jump out of those orbitals that they have around the center of the nucleus. And then those electrons are more free to exchange between different materials and also to flow within the same material. So here are some examples of electrical conductors. Metals are really great examples of electrical conductors. So we've got silver, gold, copper, steel, also seawater. Why seawater? Well, seawater has salt in it. And with the saltiness, the saline solution of seawater, you can get free ions that can move around within the material. And so you can set up a flow of charge. Some really great examples of insulators are rubber, glass, oil, diamonds, and wood, as long as it's dry, not wet. Materials that are wet tend to be better conductors of electricity. So if the wood is wet, it will not be as good of an insulator as it is when it is dry. Our insulators don't really allow for the free flow of electrons. If you have a neutral insulator, you can polarize the molecules. That means you can align them in a particular way. You can also polarize conductors. Polarization is the separation of charges in an object that overall remains neutral. Here we've got two insulators. Here are the molecules inside the insulator. They have a neutral charge. I have a positive charge and a negative charge. We're going to bring in a conductor nearby that has an excess of positive charges. Like charges repel, opposite charges attract. So if we bring a positively charged body close to the insulator here, you can force the molecules inside the insulator to align so that the negative end of the molecule is attracted toward our positive conductor. And then you can get polarization of the material inside the insulator. Now let's think about how we can polarize a conductor. So in the conductor, you have electrons that are free to move within the material. We're going to bring in a negatively charged object near the conductor, but we're not going to touch the conductor. We're bringing in this negatively charged object that's going to force all of the free electrons inside the conductor to want to repel from that. And those free electrons are going to try to move far away as they can to the other side of the conductor. And then that leaves an excess of positive charges in the conductor on the side that's nearest this negatively charged object that we brought close to the conductor. That's one way that we can polarize a conductor. We saw how we could exchange charges by rubbing objects together. We saw how we can polarize materials. Now we're going to talk about how you can charge objects by induction and by contact. To charge something by induction, you induce a charge on an object without physically touching that object. So what we're going to do is we are going to force one of these spheres here to have a positive charge and one of the spheres to have a negative charge without touching either of the two charges. Okay, so first we're going to have two spheres that are neutral and they're touching each other. We've got same number of positive and negative charges on both of these spheres. Now we're going to use polarization. We're going to bring a positively charged rod nearby. Now, since these two are touching, the electrons are free to move. Because we're bringing this positively charged rod nearby, all of the excess negative charges are going to migrate close to the positive rod. And now we're going to separate these two. We're going to separate them. And when we've separated them, we already induced charge separation here. Now, when we separate them, this sphere over here has an excess of positive charges. This sphere over here has an excess of negative charges. So we've induced a positive charge on one of the spheres and a negative charge on the other sphere without having this rod here touch either of those two objects. So this is charge by induction. When we charge by contact, a really great example of charging by contact is using this apparatus that we call an electroscope, and you can actually make one of your own. Here is an electroscope. We have a metal rod right here. The end of this metal rod is kind of outside the apparatus. The inside of the metal rod is inside the apparatus, and at the end of it are these two little foil pieces. Often they're gold foil, but they could be any other type of foil. We are going to watch a demonstration of charging by contact in the electroscope. So here's our electroscope. We've got the rod running here. One end of it has a knob that's also a conductor. And then we've got, there's two little leaves of gold foil that are hanging inside here. So this is a gold leaf electroscope, gold foil leaf electroscope. So what's going to happen is that this person is going to rub this piece of fabric on their arm, and they're going to generate an excess of negative charges on this piece of fabric. And they're going to bring that piece of fabric near the knob here of our gold leaf electroscope. And you see that when they bring, they're not touching this piece of fabric on this knob, but they're bringing it near the knob. That's going to force a charge separation inside here. So now the knob becomes positively charged by polarization, and the leaves down here become negatively charged. These two little leaves that are hanging down here, they become negatively charged. Like charges want to repel each other. And so those little leaves, they spread out from each other because they have an excess of negative charges. Now they're going to remove that negatively charged piece of fabric away. That induced polarization is no longer there. Then the charges redistribute so that now all parts of this metal piece of the apparatus come back to the neutral distribution of charge. Now we're going to charge by contact. Now we're going to bring in that negatively charged piece of fabric again. That's going to cause a charge separation inside this metal piece here. The negative charges are going to want to repel towards this end. So now we have an excess of negative charges down here, which leaves us with an excess of positive charges up here. Now we're going to bring in a finger, and we're going to touch the knob there. When we touch it, then the free electrons that were down here in the leaf that were separated when we forced our induced our polarization here, these free charges that were in the leaf are gonna flow through that person's finger and down into the earth. So at this instant, we have a distribution of charges such that now our gold leaf down here becomes neutral, and those parts of the leaves that were kind of trying to separate because they had like charges, now those the charge distribution on the leaf is such that it's essentially neutral, and then the leaves are going to come back down and collapse on each other. And so that's what we have right here. Okay, so in this process, remember we started out with a net neutral charge on this piece. We induced charge separation. We had an excess of negative charges down here, an excess of positive charges up here. We touched on the top. This excess, some of the excess negative charges here flow through the person's finger and into the earth. So essentially, when we touch by contact with the finger, we are removing electrons from this system. Now that piece of negatively charged fabric was removed slowly, our finger that was touching the knob here removed some of those electrons that were down here in the gold leaf. And then that leaves this entire apparatus here with a deficiency of electrons or an excess of positive charges. So now our entire apparatus here is going to have a positive overall charge And then we also get those gold leaves at the bottom separating from each other again. Then that is one way that we can get charge by contact.